Welcome back to the Jeff Vaughn Show, a podcast on the news and about the news and how it's covered and not covered. It is Friday, September 6th. So far, so good on my Friday podcast schedule to get it done. It is late afternoon here in Los Angeles, and I'm so happy to be in front of the microphone and talking to you today, not only about stories that happened this week, but stories that are coming up. We got the debate. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. I'm going to follow up on the Langer's Deli story that I did last week. I got brand new information. I teased that last week. I have that information for you today. We did talk about that debate last week, the one that's coming up. A couple of things that I thought that might happen if Kamala Harris bombs badly in that debate. If you want to hear what those two options are, if she bombs badly, go back to the previous podcast before this one. I kind of give my thoughts on that, which includes an October surprise. So we'll touch on that just a little bit because the debate is coming up on Tuesday in just a few days. I will be covering that as well, just a little bit here, but mainly that CNN interview that happened. I haven't had a chance to really talk about that on this podcast. I needed time to go through all of the tapes. There were three segments. I'm going to talk about that in this podcast today. And I'm also going to talk about the bearded butchers. They've been banned, and you probably don't know what I'm talking about. I'm going to introduce you to them, tell you a little bit about their story, and also what has happened to them on social media. That's coming up here in just moments on this podcast. But first, I'm also going to do a bad dad joke for you as well. I'm going to end with that. So I got a bad dad joke for you. But first, I just want to talk about this. This is something I've been thinking quite a lot about lately as I watch the news. I think this is more than just local. I think it's on a national level as well. And you could say it's national because obviously local stations throughout the nation have this issue, in my opinion, but also on the national scale related to cable TV news and whatnot. It's really the talent. I now believe, and I didn't think this way a few years ago, but now I believe the best journalists are on the sidelines. And you should be concerned about that as a news consumer, because the best people on TV, on the radio, and writing the news stories in your local newspaper are not the best journalists in your neighborhood, in your city. And here's the reason why. It really kind of came to a critical mass with me just last week when a former colleague and a friend of mine called me up. This woman has a lot of experience in the news business. She is a woman who is middle-aged and who speaks four languages and has a vast network of sources. This is specific to Los Angeles, but also I believe she has really good sources in New York City as well. One of those reporters that can just flesh out a story after a few phone calls and get down to the nitty-gritty on anything and everything that is happening or is going to happen in the city because she is connected. And I really appreciate those kinds of reporters. I believe I was that kind of reporter when I was in Detroit for 10 years. I was a crime reporter. I built up sources. If something happened and there was breaking news, we needed to find out information, I'd make a couple phone calls and have the story locked down. And that was very beneficial for the viewers and the listeners because they get that benefit of the latest information. Well, that's not happening now. So back to a friend of mine who's in the business but is really struggling to try to find some freelance work here in Los Angeles. Although she is extremely qualified, a lot of experience, speaks several languages, including Spanish, and is very good at what she does, has a number of resources and sources, and can, again, turn a story on a dime. So there was a particular story that happened just last week, and I'm not going to mention the story because I would have to then describe it, and I don't want to do that. It is one of the bigger stories last week, but it's almost a somewhat common story in almost every American city. But it was a big enough story that it had a little bit of attention here in Los Angeles. And I was following this because I follow the news, and my friend called me up and said, I just got a phone call from this police agency and from a couple of cops from this police agency, this center part of the story. And they called me up and said, who do I talk to now to get the right information on the air? Because they're seeing the stories that are happening on TV and they're not getting the right information. And she said, I don't know, because in the past they would call her and say, you know, I'd call you up, I'd give you the information, and that would be the information that would end up on air, and that was the right information. And also it was, information that would advance a story. So she was frustrated and called me and said, you know, this and this and this and this about the story that I had been following. I was like, my gosh, I haven't seen that in the news. She's like, I know. My sources are calling me and telling me that nobody is reporting this. I was like, I'm sad to hear that. But I'm also not completely surprised, I told my friend. So I get frustrated. She's frustrated over the lack of information and over the lack of sourcing. So it's interesting that this person is available to do freelance work here in Los Angeles and doesn't get called upon. And it's sad because everybody gets paid the same if you're in Los Angeles and you're a freelance reporter because you're a union member. So it's all basically a per hour gig, and the per hour salary or the per hour rate is decided by the union. So you would think the stations would get those freelancers that know the lay of the land, that have lived here for a number of years, that have the sources that can turn the information. But they're not. Here is a friend of mine with vast experience, has the sources, and is not getting called to freelance, but yet other people are. So it was interesting what she told me about. She used to be on the freelance list for the station. And then she was dropped off, and then they started going to somebody else. And that person that's now above her on the list was somebody they brought in from Sacramento, who's 20 years younger, who's not even from here, who has no sources, who doesn't even know where to go. You know, dispatch will tell them where to go, but doesn't know the agency, doesn't already know the players, if it's a police department, who to contact. And that's sad, but that's happening everywhere. The best journalists right now are on the sidelines, just like my friend, who has sources, who has information, could help the viewer, can get the information out more quickly, and can help the station. But the stations are not, they don't covet these people anymore. And I don't know why. I've talked to other friends of mine in other markets that are kind of in similar situations. And they were let go, or they were not invited to do freelance anymore in favor of people that are younger from out of the market. And again, it's not that they're saving money. If you're a freelancer, we all get paid the same. They all get paid the same. So why wouldn't you have somebody who's here already, who's got the sources and the contacts? I just don't get it. I really don't get it. And for her to say, I have police that are calling me and saying, where do I call to get the right information out, is really a sad display of where news currently is in local news stations across the country. I've worked in a number of markets. I have friends. I still have sources that call me from time to time. And, you know, they tell me, if it was you, I'd call you up and it would get on the air. And, you know, these police agencies obviously want to show that they're doing a good job. And they're also there when there are bad times as well. But when you don't have that anymore, don't have those relationships, I think the viewer, you, really suffer. And I just don't really understand why that is. But I'm not completely surprised, because experience has become a bad thing. I've actually been told that my experience makes others feel uncomfortable. That would be the younger people in that newsroom. Age discrimination is rampant, I'm told, in corporate America. And I can attest to that, at least in the little places I've been, in the little sphere around me. I've seen that. when somebody has experience, it makes others feel bad. And so I don't know if that's the motivation as to why my friend is not getting gigs. I don't know. But it sure seems like it. And you, the news consumer, is the one who's missing out. And the stations, too, but they don't see it that way. I don't know why they choose to do that. I don't have a solution. Well, I do. You need to hire experienced people with sources to get the job done to serve the viewer. But I don't think that that's part of the mission statement for a lot of local news stations anymore. So that's just kind of a rant. I'll wrap it up. If you have experienced age discrimination in corporate America, I'd love to hear your examples. I want to start doing kind of a series on this because I think it is a big issue. It may or may not be the same situation that you have witnessed or maybe have a friend, but I'm certainly available to contact and to reach out and to maybe kind of ferret out some of these stories and find out the reason why this is happening. Experience. I don't know if it's age discrimination as much as it is experience. It seems like if you're experienced, that's a bad thing. And I do think it's because the people that lack the experience don't feel comfortable with the people with experience. And that's a real problem. I mean, it used to be that you wanted to have experienced people around and you could learn from them. That's not the case anymore. I'd love to get your input on this. And if you feel that there's some sort of like story in your world, then reach out to me. I'm on all the socials. I'm on Twitter. I'm on Instagram. I'm on Facebook. I'm on TikTok. I'm on YouTube. And on all those different platforms, you can certainly reach out to me. Let's get something started where I can maybe showcase some of these stories that people have. That's my story. Actually, my friend's story about how she's experienced, she's qualified, she's capable, but yet her experience seems to be the reason why she's not getting a job. Let's talk about the Bearded Butchers. You probably don't know anything about them. Maybe you do. They have a large following, like 7 million people on all the different platforms. I found out about the Bearded Butchers just because I like from time to time to get on YouTube and just kind of cruise through the videos. And I do like to, I like beef. I like smoking meat and I like steak. And I am by no means like on the carnivore diet, but I do like to eat meat. And I like to smoke meat. I have a smoker in my backyard. I did ribs last week. I'm really into doing tri-tip a lot lately. I do brisket and burn ends and, you know, pulled pork and pork shoulder and pork butt, all that sort of stuff. I have a big smoker. It's a Yoder loaded witch top. Big, big, big sucker. I enjoy it. So I started watching the Bearded Butchers because they do cuts of meat on their YouTube channel and on Instagram. And it's very, for me, it's very educational because it's somebody that's really good at their job and I get to watch them do it. I mean, I have to admit, it is like watching other people work, but it is so educational. I found out so much about the different cuts of meat. I found out so much about how to cook because they have little offshoot videos where they're cooking some of the meat. And that's really why I got involved with watching the Bearded Butchers. They're a couple of brothers. Perkins, I believe, is their last name. It's a good educational channel. They showcase their trade. And these are good, trades guys, tradesmen, blue-collar guys. This is a craft that's not really appreciated anymore. Now, I have a good butcher near where I live, and I go to Costco, which is good. I understand that Costco started out as a butcher years and years and years ago, and that's one of the reasons why they have good meat. And I agree. I get a lot of meat at Costco. But from time to time, I go to my local butcher who is so much better. I mean, you can go in there and you can say, I want this, I want that. I like to get my beef ribs there. Anyway, the Bearded Butchers. So at some point in time in July, I believe it was Facebook, shut them down. And they don't know why. It suppressed all their information, continues to suppress all their information. They believe that they were shadow banned. Their account was suspended for no reason. There was, after they dug into it, something about fraud and deception or something like that. I don't know if it's just some sort of boilerplate reason as to why they did it. But they were talking a little bit about how, I mean, I noticed when they were banned, because I watched them, I noticed there were no new videos. And all of a sudden, they're just, they're gone. And that is continuing to affect them today. Here it is almost 2 months later. And they believe that their content was getting shadow banned. They don't have a reason. And I just want to spend a little bit of time just kind of maybe you and me think about why this happened. So they're butchers. Was it the knives? Now, they don't kill animals. They just have the meat hanging up in the locker, and then they'll take the meat down, and they'll cut, and they'll show you all the different cuts. Again, very educational, I believe. Is it the knives? But, I mean, cooking shows are all over the place, and they use knives. Is it the animals? I mean, they don't show them killing the animals. They just show them the meat hanging up and before they process it. Is it that? Is it the carnivore diet? They do advocate for a carnivore diet. They say that they do it ethically and humanely. They're environmentally stable. They support family farms. Maybe it's that. I don't know. Maybe they're anti-trade, the reason why. And they don't want people that have, I don't know, the skills. Or maybe they're trying to keep a corporate outlook on this instead of a local small business owner. And I have to say, there is an attack. I've seen it. Attack on small business. That happened during COVID. I have a friend of mine who runs a cigar shop, and he was shut down. And he has cigars. He has a humidor. And he also has liquor. He sells wine. He sells bourbon and scotch. The same as Total Wine. Total Wine has a little humidor in there as well. Total Wine was allowed to stay open, but they shut him down. So maybe Facebook doesn't like small business? I don't know. Now, one of the things they brought up is maybe it's because on some of the channels that they have, they hunt and they show, but they don't show them killing animals. They just show them going out and bow hunting, which I believe is still okay, right? I don't know, but I'm going to get into this a little bit more. I'm going to feature this on future podcasts. I'm also going to do a story on it for the Daily News Drop. And thank you so much for all those people that are tuning into the Daily News Drop. We're going to do a longer form story on just the bearded butchers. I think in the end, probably what happened is somebody along the line at Facebook was offended. Offended by the knives, offended by the meat, offended by it being beef. I don't know. But I think somewhere along the line, somebody was offended, and then they suppressed that information. We're to the point now where we're confusing feelings with rights. Like hurting your feelings is violence. Somebody along the line got offended by watching these bearded butchers cut up meat. And again, it's very educational. They describe where this meat is, where it comes from. They describe the animal. They describe everything. And actually, it's a great DIY. I found that watching them gave me more information when I went to the butcher. And when I picked out, and I've tried different cuts of meat because of these guys. And so I don't really know. And I have reached out to the bearded butchers. They did not want to do anything on camera. They did not want to do anything on audio. They just referred me to their YouTube page where they explained this whole thing. And that's what I'm talking about, kind of regurgitating to you today. So they didn't say this, but I'm going to say it again. I think probably what happened somewhere along the line, somebody was offended by the knives or the beef or the meat, and then they decided we're going to get them and suppress the information and deplatform them. Somebody out there feels like it's their right because their feelings were hurt. That's my take. So look for the story soon on the Daily News Drop. Of course, that's on all the different socials, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and we're going to follow up on that. And if you have any sort of input that you have, maybe I'm way off on why you think that might happen, on why they were deplatformed, then let me know. Let's go now to a follow-up on the Langer's Deli situation. I talked about this in the previous podcast. I'm going to read the story here just to give you an update, and then I'm going to give you the latest, because as of last week, we were still waiting to hear back from LAPD, and we were still waiting to hear back from a city councilwoman, and this will explain, and I'll tell you the new information on the other side. So here's the story. When you've been in business since 1947 in Los Angeles, you are doing something right. Langer's Deli has a great product. The number 19 sandwich has been called the world's best sandwich by famous chefs, foodies, and customers for over 70 years. Langer's treats their employees like family. They're part of a union. They get health care, paid vacation, and get this, each employee during their shift, two free meals. That's amazing. He treats them right. But owner Norm Langer says he may have to close his deli to keep his employees and his customers safe. You've heard this before. Crime is up. Homelessness is up. Fentanyl use is up. The zombies are out. And a lot of people don't feel safe. It's the same situation, just a different business. This time it's Langer speaking out. They're located right across the street from MacArthur Park, where crime, homelessness, and drugs are out of control. So Langer told the LA Times the city needs to increase police patrols, clean up MacArthur Park. The Neighborhood Association agreed. Their president says, quote, you'll see bodies on top of each other, completely passed out, with the stench of fentanyl everywhere. People walking around like zombies, end quote. Neighbors say the decline came about 2 years ago after Eunice Hernandez took office as a city councilwoman and called for defunding the police. She ran on that platform. Hernandez represents the district where Langer's is located. So the LA Times article ends there, but I take it just a step further in the Daily News Drop, and I added this. Hernandez, a member of the Democratic Socialist Party, that is what she says, her words, she's a member of the Democratic Socialist Party, wants to abolish police and prisons. She voted against raises and bonuses for LAPD and has called for dismantling the department, saying police do not make our communities safer. So, is the lack of enforcement near MacArthur Park because LAPD does not feel supported in Hernandez's district? But you can't blame them. Or has Hernandez pressured police to stop doing their job in her district, which of course would affect Langer's Deli? I feel like we need answers. The Daily News Drop on the story, asking questions, and I hope to provide a follow-up very, very soon. But as it is, it's almost 3 weeks later, and here's the update. So I sent a couple of questions, several questions, actually, to LAPD and to the city councilwoman Eunice Hernandez as well. So I'll just give you the question and then their answer. So my question to LAPD and the city council member, does council member Hernandez's stance on defunding police, abolishing police and prisons affect LAPD's response and policing in her district? LAPD responded, while council member Hernandez has an idea of how to approach public safety, LAPD remains committed to maintaining safety and addressing quality of life concerns, regardless of which council district Angelenos live in. LAPD strives to deliver consistent service to everyone. It's a good answer. Obviously, I don't know if that's the truth, but it definitely is a good answer. Does LAPD feel supported in her district? I asked them. LAPD appreciates the professionalism and open dialogue with Councilmember Hernandez and her team. They actively engage with us on district matters such as homeless encampment cleanups. We've also worked together with her to provide her staff and the councilperson with a better understanding of crime issues through ride-alongs. While their focus tends to be on outreach, support, and harm reduction, we value their collaboration and continue to work towards shared goals for the community. Has Council Member Hernandez suggested that LAPD not police in her district? No. LAPD responds. The council member has not suggested that LAPD cease policing in her district. I'm being completely upfront with you and reading this word for word, by the way. And that's what's great about a podcast is you can do that. If I'm sitting in front of the TV camera, I have maybe a minute to do the story. So this is obviously longer than that, but it's giving you a much broader look at this. One last question. What is LAPD's approach to policing in a district where the council person has a different public safety philosophy? The response, LAPD's role is to work collaboratively with all city officials to address community needs. We are committed to solving problems, maintaining public safety, and enhancing the quality of life in every neighborhood we serve. Although approaches may differ, we strive to balance enforcement with outreach and support programs, always with the goal of finding effective solutions for the community. Okay. LAPD did a good job. I thank them for getting back with me, albeit it was a few weeks later, but I was happy to give them that much time because I thought it was a well thought out response, and I appreciate that. And I will tell them such. And I think that that's a good way to respond. However, LAPD sources of mine say it's really hard to do your job in her district. One, because they don't get the support. And two, just the fact that she wants to defund the police and has called police, she said, police do not make our communities safer. Imagine being a cop on the beat and you're in that district, District 1, I believe, MacArthur Park, and that's the precinct, and that's who you serve. Now, these cops are professional. They go out there, they protect and serve people like Langer's employees and customers. God love them for what they're doing. I support them. But obviously, there's more to that than what LAPD has said. Sources of mine within the department have said it's hard to do what needs to be done in that district. I want to wrap it up there with that story. I think what's interesting is LAPD got back with me, but Hernandez never did. I don't expect that she will. I have sent her several email messages, not only her, but to her public relations people, followed up with phone calls and have not heard back. And I've given up. And I think it's safe to say that no comment from Hernandez related to Langer's Deli, which is sad because that's her district. I noticed that the mayor went to Langer's to talk to the owner about it. And that was good. She should do that. I thought that was good. But it also should have been Eunice's Hernandez as well. We'll continue to follow this story and look for it on the Daily News Drop, also here on this podcast. Okay, let's talk about something going forward now. We got a debate coming up, right? And it's coming up on Tuesday. And I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on it because it hasn't happened yet. I will definitely be watching, and I will be talking about it here on this podcast, also on the various media channels that I'm on. I understand Harris didn't like the debate rules. I'm just going to drop this real quick about this debate. The rules were for this September 10th debate on ABC News with David Muir and Lindsay Davis is that when the person responding to the moderator is talking, the other candidate's microphone would be muted. So that was agreed upon. And I don't know if that's a good thing or bad thing. I don't care. As somebody who wants to watch it to get a better understanding of where both candidates are, and as a news person who wants to find out as much as possible about the candidates, especially Kamala Harris, because I don't know as much about her, then I will tune in and hope that I can get that information. And I don't care about the microphones, but she does. The disadvantage, because in her mind, the mic would be muted. And you have to ask yourself, why did she oppose that? So there was a little kerfuffle about she wasn't going to do the debate because they're going to mute the microphones. And I guess ABC maintained that and said, well, we're going to do it anyway. So she's going to have to live with it. But the reason is just, it baffles me. Why would you, I mean, it's very childish almost. And that's something that I just don't, and both candidates, by the way, a lot of politicians are childish. I'm not just focusing on Kamala Harris and the Harris camp for this. There are practically all politicians are babies, in my opinion. But somebody who wants to be the president of the United States is bickering over something like this. Really, it's hard for me to see you in the position of president and making hard decisions if you're quabbling and quibbling about a microphone at a debate. So that's coming up on Tuesday. And a week from today, we'll talk a little bit more about that. However, I want to spend some time talking about the CNN interview. That happened, and that was before Labor Day. And now that it's after Labor Day, of course, the political season is ramped up big time. Going to go all the way until November, of course. This is big. This is the time of the year where you're just going to be inundated with all politics. So that CNN interview, that was an hour interview. That was the one with Harris and her running mate for Harris's first interview in a long time. So let me just read to you this real quick that I wrote. It's after Labor Day. That marks the official start to the election season. Presidential election between former President Trump and GOP, he's the GOP nominee, versus current Vice President and Democratic nominee Kamala Harris is coming up. So I want to spend some time on the recent Harris interview with her running mate Tim Walz on CNN that occurred just before Labor Day, late last week. So here's what we know. And you know, if you're in the news, there was all kinds of talk afterwards about the interview. So here's my take. It was the first televised interview with Kamala Harris since becoming the de facto Democratic nominee a month earlier, and 2 weeks after the DNC, where she was officially nominated as the Democrats' nominee. It really was the first significant sit-down the VP has done since the NBC News interview when Lester Holt corrected Harris on the border. That was more than 3 years ago. And think about it. I looked back. There's not a lot out there of her in the public since then. Now, the one-hour taped and edited CNN interview was heavy on commercials, padded with campaign video. The actual interview segment only took up 27 minutes. It was an hour long. I think it might have been just short of an hour. But the three segments totaled 27 minutes. Harris was asked most of the questions, with Walz fielding four. So here's where it gets interesting. Right after this, online sources were saying that there was as many as 41 minutes of the interview left on the cutting room floor that they edited it, which would make sense because you have unnecessary chit-chat, pleasantries at the beginning. I mean, I've sat down for interviews. Oftentimes you meet the person, you sit down, you say hi, you talk about your kids, you talk about the day, then you sit down and then you start. So you take the 27 minutes of the aired interview, 41 minutes of what was reported as unaired video, that's 68 minutes. That's about right for an hour interview after the pleasantries and everything, right? But I really saw no evidence of the 41 minutes. I couldn't find it anywhere. It was on social media, and I didn't see any reputable sources, in my opinion, that could verify 41 minutes. But what is interesting is a CNN spokesperson told Mediaite the interview was 27 minutes long and aired in full, and that the interview was pre-taped but not edited. Pre-taped but not edited. That's from CNN. It was edited. There are clearly edits, and I'm going to explain. Part one of the interview, by the way, you can find this on the CNN YouTube page. They have the Kamala Harris Walz interview, part one, part two, part three. So I went through it. Part one of the interview is 8 minutes and 13 seconds long. At 2 minutes and 5 seconds in, there's an edit. Now, it appears to be the same question posed from Kamala Harris to Tim Walz, but it does go from a one shot to a two shot of the candidates. So it might have just been a camera angle is all it was. It's kind of ticky-tack, and I don't really consider that a big edit. I think it might have just been an edit from one to two, because you went from Dana Bash and Kamala Harris to a close-up of Tim Walz answering the question. So I don't really think that's much of an edit. But part two was 8 minutes and 29 seconds long. At 5 minutes and 35 seconds, there is a clear edit. There is a flash. There is a clear edit. Now, remember, CNN said there was no editing. It doesn't take a person like me, an old radio and TV guy, to see where there's an edit. You could see it for yourself at 5:35 in part two. Part three was the big one. That's 10 minutes and 16 seconds long. At 3 minutes and 2 seconds in, there's an edit. There's clearly an edit. I think that one might have been more than a flash screen. I think it might have been a graphic that swooshed in. Also, there's an edit at 7 minutes and 40 seconds in. Clearly an edit. So something was left out. Something was edited. Something was left out. CNN said it wasn't edited. They're lying to you, or they're incompetent and they don't know. I don't know. Probably the former, not the latter. It was also reported that a transcript of the entire interview was not made public, but I did find a printed version of the interview on CNN's website. But here's the deal. It follows the interview basically word for word, so it doesn't include any editing. So when you get to the point where the transcript matches the video and there's an edit, there's no mention of that in the transcript. You read the transcript and you think it's just a continuation of the conversation. It's not. So there's something going on there, some fudging of the record for sure. Also, in the online CNN transcript, they have overtalk, which is when people are speaking at the same time. I didn't see any of that in the interview, but they mentioned overtalk in the transcript, but it's not exactly mentioned what it is, what the overtalk was. So there's really no detail there. Nonetheless, it was a very short interview, and it appears that the Harris-Walz campaign demanded that. CNN anchor Anderson Cooper, in leading up to the event on that evening, said as much. He said, quote, "This is how she and her campaign wanted to do it," end quote. So CNN did not interfere or push back on the rules for the interview. They let the Harris-Walz campaign make the rules. So when you hear that, were the rules that it was going to be 30 minutes? Were the rules that you need to edit this out? Were the rules that take this out of the transcript? I mean, I don't know, but it certainly seems like it. I mean, I don't know for certain. It's a gray area, right? But if Anderson Cooper says this is how she and her campaign wanted to do it, well, they bowed down to her. They did exactly what they wanted to do. And that is not the job of a news organization. CNN did not interfere or push back on the rules for that interview. And that's sad. Now, I'm going to preface this by saying I understand these politicians are not making themselves available. I think that's a shame. Kamala Harris is not doing interviews on a regular basis. So they build it up and build it up and build it up. And they go and, you know, find a favorable entity like CNN that will, yes, whatever you want. We just want to do an interview. Let them make the rules, whatever you want. And CNN benefits from that because it gets eyeballs. I think there was 6.3 million people that watched that. And of course, it's going to be forever remembered and uploaded. And I watch it on YouTube. People watch it on YouTube. And obviously, that's a big plus for them. But a news organization should not be doing that. They should, if they are going to do any sort of interview, all of it should be released. You can live stream from the very beginning to the very end. That's big now. That would have explained the overtalk, that would explain the chit-chat, that would explain that there was no 41 minutes. But now that's a gray area. I don't know. I don't understand why CNN just did not live stream it and be done with it. It just looks bad for CNN. For you as a news consumer, and for me as a news person, I shake my head. Because I'll tell you what, over the years, I've had politicians pressure me. I was in Detroit, and I was chasing down the mayor, Dennis Archer at the time, on a story. And I really don't remember what the story was. But it was something related to crime, because I was a crime beat reporter, and I needed the mayor, and he was kind of dodging me for a few days. And I decided to go to a press conference that the mayor was having that was unrelated. It was actually around some sort of charity event or something like that. So I'm asked questions unrelated to the press conference to try to get answers on another story that I've been working on for days and days and needed to get the mayor on the record. And I could tell when I asked the question, he was mad. And he would not answer the question. And he told me that I was interrupting this press conference that was unrelated. And my answer was, well, you've been dodging me. What else am I supposed to do? You're a public servant. You're supposed to answer questions. I haven't heard from you in 2 weeks. So I'm going to ask the questions when I have the chance. So we did. And I used that in my story. And before the story aired, he had one of his people call up and say, we don't want you to air that. And I said, I'm sorry, I don't work for you. And that's pretty much was always the answer I gave. I've had over the years a number of public officials that have said, I don't want you to put that out there. Or can you do this for me? And my answer has always been, nope. If you didn't like the question, you could have said no comment. And I don't work for you. And if you have a problem, call my boss. And by the way, nothing ever came from it. They never challenged me on it because they know that they're in the wrong. And I always had support from my boss. So it wasn't a big deal. But that's what CNN should have done. And everybody should do that. And when CNN doesn't, it's bad for everybody in journalism. Because it looks bad for CNN that they bent over backwards. They didn't provide a transcript, a full transcript. They edited the interview when they said they didn't. And it just underscores what everybody thinks about the media, which breaks my heart. Because when I got into journalism, you could depend on the media to be straight shooters, to be unbiased, to give you both sides, and to not lie. CNN did something here. I don't know how bad it was. It may just be a little thing. It may be an oversight. Like the little chyron that was running during the interview that said it was live when it wasn't. A lot of people are making a big deal about that. I'm like, well, it's probably just some engineer that made a goof. But when everybody I talk to says they can't trust the media, well, this is a reason why. And also, the last 5 minutes of that interview was terrible. I mean, Dana Bash asked both the candidates about their family at the DNC. I mean, come on. There's more pressing issues than to go to touchy-feely stuff about their family. I just think that in an interview in a setting like that, especially if they're controlling it, I mean, if somebody told me that, I have had politicians say, what are you going to ask me? I was like, I don't know. I don't think it's my job to tell you what I'm going to ask you. And I think if that was, because CNN and Anderson Cooper says this is what they wanted, was it Kamala Harris and Tim Walz that say, hey, look, will you ask me about my family? I mean, you got to think that was the case, right? I mean, all of this is tainted at this point in time. So let's just tie up some loose ends here. It's a problem because people just can't believe the sources of information anymore. And I don't care if you're looking at CNN or Fox News or any of these news outlets. It's just basically the feeling of the news consumer. And I got to say, I'm right there with you, especially with this. CNN did not do a good job. And I don't know that they're going to do a better job going forward. I mean, once you do this, and if she gets elected president, she's going to go back. And then she's going to set the rules. And they're just going to, I mean, we can talk about this for days. At least I could. But it's getting to be Friday evening, and I'm going to wrap it up and spend time with my family. Something to think about there related to all those topics. I hope you join me next week as well. We'll be back on the air here on this podcast. And I promised a bad dad joke. My son is so tired of hearing my bad dad jokes, but he does laugh at them. And I got this bad dad joke for you today. Hey, just a little tip. I wouldn't buy anything with Velcro. I mean, it's a total ripoff. I got to get a laugh track in here. All right, I'm Jeff Vaughn. This is the Jeff Vaughn Show, a podcast about the news, what they're doing right, what they're doing wrong. I'll see you next week. Have a great weekend, everybody.